Praise the Lord.
Gloire à Dieu.
Shall we rise up?
Levons-nous pour la prière.
Heavenly Father,
Père Céleste, nous te remercions pour nous avoir rassemblés à cette retraite des ouvriers. Merci pour le voyage sain et sauf accordé à chacun. Et merci pour ceux qui sont encore en route. Nous prions que tu les amènes sains et saufs pour se joindre à nous pour une bonne communion autour de ta parole au nom de Jésus. Nous te remercions pour nos dirigeants, te remercions pour nos pasteurs, te remercions pour nos dirigeants, tous les ouvriers. Merci Seigneur pour nous avoir rassemblés, pour nous, pour aiguiser nos épées, pour que notre travail, œuvre avec toi, pour toi, soit plus profitable dans ton royaume au nom de Jésus. Nous demandons, Seigneur, que dans tous les lieux, partout où cette retraite est organisée, que tu déverses tes bénédictions sur chacun au nom de Jésus. Nous prions, Seigneur, que tu sois de nous le type d'ouvrier que nous devrions être, le type de dirigeant que nous devrions être, pour que cette œuvre prospère dans nos mains au nom de Jésus. Parle à nos cœurs maintenant. Et commence avec nous en ce moment et continue avec nous jusqu'à la fin. Nous te remercions pour l'exaucement. Au nom de Jésus, nous prions.
I welcome you to
Je vous souhaite la bienvenue à la retraite des ouvriers en ce moment au nom de Jésus. C'est merveilleux que vous avez bien répondu et nous louons Dieu pour nos pasteurs, pour nos dirigeants, nos leaders qui vous ont informé et qui vous ont inspiré et motivé chacun à venir. Je prie que votre venue ne soit pas vaine au nom de Jésus. Comme nous sommes rassemblés, et nous devons savoir que c'est sur commandement du Seigneur lui-même. En Psaume 50,
Psaume 50, verse 5, it says, gather my saints together unto me.
Psaume 50, verset 5.
That have made covenant with me by sacrifice.
He
says, gather my saints together unto me. And over the flock of the Lord, we're gathered together as overseers, committed to the work of God and committed to do the will of God. As we're gathered together, we want to first of all understand we're gathered unto Him. That is at His command. That is because of His glory. That is because of what He wants to do in our own lives and then in our ministries, in the lives of other people around us. So we gather together unto Him so that He Himself will speak to us. Will speak to us in Jesus' name. We gather together unto Him so that He will cleanse us, He will purge us, He will prepare us for greater service, and we will do exploits for the Lord in Jesus' name. But then we gather together not only because of Him, we gather together number two for ourselves. We are here for ourselves to re-examine our lives, to lay our lives back on the altar again, and then to see what the Lord wants to do and what He wants to command us. We want to examine what we have done in the past. We want to examine what we are doing today. I want to examine the call of God upon our lives, even for the future. So for ourselves, we are gathering together unto Him. But we are also gathering together because of other people. There are people under our leadership. There are people under our ministry. There are people that depend upon us to understand the word of God and to understand the way of God. And because of them, we are gathering together at this workers' retreat. And I pray that all the purposes that God has in mind for bringing us together for Himself, for His glory, for ourselves, for our own godliness, and for other people, for the gracious ministration of the Lord through us in their lives. I pray that all those purposes will be fulfilled in Jesus' name. Look at that verse 5 again. It says, gather my saints together unto me. That's a command, the command of the Lord. That means then, anytime the Lord grants us chance, and He says, gather together again, whether we're gathering together for worship, or we're gathering together for a conference like this for workers, we know that this is a commandment of the Lord, and it's something for us to respond to promptly. And then He says, those that have made a covenant with me by sacrifice. That means that as we come to the Lord, in this workers retreat, we're not just to let things go just by itself. We're just here, no, we're to make covenant with him by sacrifice. Number one, the sacrifice of the Lord Jesus Christ, that full sacrifice, that final sacrifice, that efficacious sacrifice, because we are cleansed through the blood of Jesus, and everything we have through the blood of Jesus. But not only his sacrifice, our own sacrifice, that we lay our life on the altar and we offer our life, surrender completely unto him, so that his purpose in our lives will be fulfilled. It will be fulfilled in Jesus' name. As you look at the program, you'll see that the program is quite full. And it's quite, we can even say it's crowded. But because we have just today and tomorrow, Friday and Saturday, we need to give our very best. And we need to be here so that as we are here, all that the Lord wants to give to us, he will give to us in Jesus' name. Tonight, we're looking at the message, Overcomers in the Present Evil World. In the present evil world. We're looking at Galatians chapter 1. Galatians chapter 1. I'm reading from verse 4. In Galatians chapter 1, verse 4, it says, who gave himself for us that he might deliver us from this present evil world. And then he goes on to say, according to the will of God and our Father. The Lord makes us to understand that the present world we're living in is an evil world. It's a world that is sold to the devil. A world that is controlled by the devil. A world that is given to evil. And it says, this present world, this present evil world. But the Lord does not want us to remain in the present evil world and be like them, and think like them, and talk like them, and walk like them, and live exactly as they're living. It says, he gave himself for us. That he is the Lord Jesus Christ, the purpose of his sacrifice and the purpose of his dying on the cross of Calvary is so that he might deliver us from the present evil world. That means then when we talk of salvation, our salvation includes deliverance from the present evil world. If we're not delivered from the present evil world, if we're not different from the present evil world, it means that his sacrifice has not become effective, efficacious, mighty, and powerful in our lives. When the sacrifice of Jesus, when the atonement of Jesus, when the prayer of Jesus, when the ministration of Jesus becomes effective in our lives, it says there is one thing it will do. It will deliver us from this present evil world. And when we're delivered out of the present evil world, we'll not talk like the world, or think like the world, or live like the world, or manage our lives like the world. Anymore. In fact, it tells us in this same Galatians chapter 4, verse 3 to 7. Galatians chapter 4. I'm reading here from verse 3. It says from verse 3 to verse 7. Even so we, when we were children, were in bondage under the elements of the world. You know, he's talking of the past. He said, when we were in bondage, we were in bondage to the elements of the world. But when the fullness of time was come, God sent forth his son, an image of a woman, a image under the law, to redeem them that were made, that were under the law, that we might receive the adoption of sons. That is, when we come to the Lord, we come to the Lord in repentance. We come to the Lord for regeneration. We come to the Lord for the new birth. We're turned around. And he tells us here, we are now delivered from the things of the past. And it says in verse 6, and because he has sons, God has sent forth the Spirit of his Son into you, into your hearts, crying, Abba, Father. Wherefore, thou art no more a servant. We're no more servants to sin. We're no more servants to the world. We're no more servants to our own selfish will. But it says, but a son. And if a son, then an heir of God through Christ. We're looking at Galatians chapter 6. And I'm reading there from verse 14. Galatians chapter 6, verse 14. It says, but God forbid that I should glory, save in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom the world is crucified unto me, and I unto the world. You can see then the difference that Christ makes in our lives, and the difference he wants to make in your life. That when you come to the Lord, you are crucified to the world, and the world is crucified unto you. Obviously, there's a separation. Obviously, there's a distinction between the believer and the world. There's a mighty difference, a glorious difference now, because of that great thing the Lord himself has done. And I pray that this effective work of Christ on Calvary will be visible in every one of our lives in Jesus' name. And that's how we come to overcome. We overcome the world, the present evil world. 1 John chapter 5. I'm reading from verse 4. It says, for whatsoever is born of God overcomes the world. We need to be born again so that we can overcome the present evil world. And it says, for whosoever, anywhere, anytime, is born of God, overcomes the world. Then it goes on to say, and this is the victory that overcomes the world, even our faith. We'll put our faith, our trust, our confidence in the Lord Jesus Christ for what he has done. That faith makes us to be overcomers. In verse 5, who is he that overcomes the world but he that believeth that Jesus is the Son of God? And as we believe that faith works effectually in us, and it works in a dynamic way in our lives, then we become overcomers. I pray that the victory of the cross and the victory of Christ will be visible in every one of our lives in Jesus' name. I'm looking at this under three subtitles. Number one, the description and the danger of the present evil world. The description, according to the Bible, according to the word of God, the description and the danger of the present evil world. Number two, deliverance and dominion over the polluted evil world. Our deliverance, our dominion over the polluted evil world. Number three, the duty of disciples when the world, and the Lord has left us in this world for a purpose. He wants us to get something done. And now we're looking at the duty of disciples in the perverted evil world. The duty of disciples in the perverted evil world. Number one is the description of the danger of the present evil world. We're coming back to Galatians chapter 1. In Galatians chapter 1, reading from verse 4. Galatians chapter 1, reading from verse 4. It says in verse 4, why don't you back up to verse 3? It says, grace be unto you and peace from God the Father and from our Lord Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us. He gives the glory to God. He gives the glory to Christ. He gives the reason for our deliverance from the world, present evil world. He gives that to the Lord Jesus Christ. And he says, it's one that gave himself for us. It must be so serious, must be so necessary, needful, that we're delivered from the present evil world for him to give himself, to surrender himself, to sacrifice himself, to give up his very life for that purpose. And if he found it necessary, then it must be an important subject, an important matter. And you need to think about that very seriously, that if this was necessary, if this was so important, if this was so compulsory, that Jesus will give his own very life, the world must be very evil, and the necessity of being delivered from the present evil world must be so necessary, who gave himself for us, for our sins. that he might deliver us from the present evil world. It says there categorically, it says there plainly, it says there without any shadow of doubt that this present world is an evil world, a world under the control of Satan, a world under the captivity of the devil, a world that is sold to sin, sold to evil. And it says because a present evil world, that's the reason we need to be delivered from it. If you look at that verse 4, it says over there, from this present evil world, according to the will of God and our Father. That means a deliverance from the present evil world is according to the will of the Father, according to the will of God. It's so important in your life, in my life, in our lives together, and in the life of the church. In Ephesians chapter 2, I'm reading from verse 1. And you are sick, quickened, who are dead in trespasses and sins, wherein in time past you walked according to the course of this world. It's referring to the past now. He said, before we knew the Lord, before we knew Christ, before we had salvation, before we were converted, before we had eternal life, we walked according to the course of this life. He's telling us the evil in the world, that is walking according to the principles of the world, walking according to the precepts of the world, actually makes us to come under the dominion of the power of the one that rules and controls and reigns in the world. And it says over here, according to the prince of the power of the air. And it says the spirit that now walketh in the children of disobedience. That means then the pronouncing, the central thing, the principal thing in the world is a spirit. And it's a spirit of disobedience. And that's the reason why the Lord is saying, because of Satan controlling the world, because of evil spirits controlling the world, and because of sin and trespasses controlling the world, it's a present evil world. And then it says in verse 3, among whom also we all had our conversation in time past. It said, where our conversation in time past, that is our manner of life, our citizenship, our conduct, our character, we had each in the world, it says, and in the lust of the flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind. And we were by nature the children of wrath, even as others. That tells us then what evil is in the world. Would you look at 2 Corinthians chapter 4? In 2 Corinthians chapter 4, reading here from verses 3 and 4. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 3 and 4. It says, but if our gospel be hid, it is hid to them that are lost. If our gospel be hid, it is hid to them that are lost, in whom the God of this world has blinded the minds of them which believe not. It tells us here that Satan is the God of this world. And there's something he does. He blindfolds the people of the world so that they will not understand the word of God. They will not understand the gospel. They will not yield to the gospel. They will not surrender to the gospel. If anyone hears the gospel and he doesn't understand, when the gospel is so plain, when the word of God is so plain, if anyone hears about the way of salvation, and the way of salvation is made so clear and so plain, and he does not understand, it says the responsibility or the blame for that should go to the devil. Is the God of this world. He hides the real gospel from the people. He hides the reason for the gospel from the people. He hides the effectiveness, the efficacious power of the gospel. He hides it from all the people of the world because they are under his control. He says, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them. Look at verse 5. It says, for we preach not ourselves, but Christ Jesus the Lord, and ourselves your servants for Jesus' sake. For God
Nous disons,
who commanded the light to shine out of darkness,
has
shined in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. It says the light is shining, the light of the gospel is very clear, that the gospel is clear, the gospel that saves, the gospel that separates us from the world, the gospel that makes a change, a dramatic change, a wonderful change, a permanent change. It says the gospel is there, and the sound of the gospel is going all over the world, and it has come to us, it has come to some of those people in the world too, and if they have not believed, it's because of the God of this world, and because of that evil sin that he does, that there is in the Bible says is a present evil world, present evil world. And if anyone is going to be saved and remain saved, he must tear himself away from the God of this world and then believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and be so attached to the Lord Jesus Christ that he'll be completely separated, detached from the devil. We're looking at Matthew chapter 4. In Matthew chapter 4, I'm reading from verse 8. Here the devil comes out very clearly to say that he is in control of this world. And as you look at what he told the Lord Jesus Christ, and Jesus did not agree with him, it was true that he had been given this world to control because of the fall of Adam and Eve. Because of that, the authority and the inheritance of the world had been given to his son. We're looking at Matthew chapter 4, verse 8. It says again, the devil taketh him up into an exceeding high mountain and showeth him all the kingdoms of the world and the glory of them. And says unto him, all these things will I give thee, if thou wilt fall down and worship me. All these things will I give thee, if thou wilt fall down and worship me. Can you see his audacity? Can you see his kind of brazen courage to tell the Lord Jesus Christ that Jesus shall fall down and worship him? And that if Jesus did that, he will give all these things of the world unto him. What a terrible sin that is, and what a terrible place the world is, that all these kingdoms and all these empires and all these riches and all these glories of the world, they actually belong to the devil. And the devil is promising that if anybody will fall down and worship him, that's what he will give unto them. And isn't that why many people, high and low, rich and poor, illiterate and educated, church-going people and irreligious people, isn't that why they are falling down and they are worshiping the devil? Because they want to have this and have this and have that. And he's telling them, I can only give you this if you worship me, if you fall down, worship me. But the Lord Jesus Christ said in verse 10, then said Jesus unto him, get thee behind me, Satan. I pray you'll be able to say the same thing. You will resist the devil and he will flee away from you in Jesus' name. But the point is very clear that because Satan controls this world and he controls all the riches, all the pleasures, all the inheritance and everything in the world, and that's why it is a present evil world. And if your heart is panting after those things, if you want to have them by all means, and you are not waiting for the Lord to give them unto you, you are going to fall down to the devil, and then the evil in the world, the power of the God of this world will capture you, captivate you, and control you. I pray that that will not be your lot in Jesus' name. And as Jesus told Satan, get thee behind me, Satan, for it is written, thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, and him only shalt thou serve. I pray that that same courage and that same trust and that same faith and that same simple-mindedness the Lord will give to us in Jesus' name. We're told in Mark chapter 4, it shows you the character of the world, the characteristics of the world, the nature of the world, the principles of the world, the pollution of the world, and the danger of the world. That's the reason why we need to be delivered out of that world. That's why we need to overcome the That's why we need to actually live our lives separate from all the influences of the world. It tells us in Mark chapter 4. Mark chapter 4. I'm reading here from verse 18 and verse 19. Mark chapter 4, verse 18. It says in verse 18, and these are they which are sown among the thorns, such as hear the word, and the cares of this world, and the deciitfulness of riches, and the loss of other things entering in, choke the word,
and it's become infructuous. La rend infructueuse.
Hearing the word, it's not enough to just hear the word. We must be so separated from the world that the influence of the world, the sins in the world, the power in the world, the pollution of the world, and the evil things in the world will not influence us so much that the world will not bear any fruit. Look at that verse 19 again. It says, the cares of this world, the people who are hearing the word of God, or the cares of the world will not allow them to benefit. There are some people that say that, well, we can go to any church, we can be in any church and still get to heaven, especially when in that place they're preaching the word. It's all right to preach the word of God, but I hope that in those churches the cares of the world are not crushing out the effectiveness of the word that we're preaching. The same thing has to come to our church here, not only at the headquarters, but all over this nation, all over this continent of Africa and beyond Africa. If we have the word on the one hand and the cares of the world on the other hand, the cares of the world will choke the word, and the word will become unfruitful. You can preach salvation. If the cares of the world are there, you'll not be able to have people that walk and actually have the salvation. You'll be preach sanctification, holiness without which no man shall see the Lord. If the cares of the world are not rooted out, taken out, burnt up, taken away from that church, the preaching of sanctification, holiness will not take root, will not be effective. We can preach that consecration, commitment to the Lord, entire commitment to the Lord, entire consecration to the Lord, divine ownership of the Lord. If the cares of the world, if they are there, all the preaching will just be superficial. It will not take any effect, because it says so by the cares of this world, and then the deceitfulness of riches. If we exalt riches and prosperity and wealth and material things above the word of God, the preaching of the word of God is there, the doctrine is there, and everything is there that we can take from the word of God, but the deceitfulness of riches is there, the passion to be rich, the desire to be rich at all costs, and we're running after that, it will choke the word, and the word of God will become unfruitful. It even says, and all that things entering in. All the things entering in. And that's why every pastor must take note. That's why every preacher must take note. That's why every overseer must take note. That it is not enough that when we say we're preaching the word, we say contending for the faith was delivered unto the saints. We lay line upon line and precept upon precept. And yet the cares of the world will not allow the word to bear fruit. And the deceitfulness of riches will not allow the word to bear fruit. And then all the cares and everything entering in will not allow the word to bear fruit. It is as we take care of the word and take care of the things of the word that they will not crouch the word away from our hearts. That's when we're going to bear fruit, and we'll bear fruit in Jesus' name. There's some people that will say, all these things don't matter. Once we stick with the word and stay with the word, they matter quite a lot, because Jesus Christ himself said that if you don't root out all those things, they will so choke the word and to become unfruitful. Actually, we're told in Romans chapter 3. Romans chapter 3. I'm reading here from verse 19, then I'll back up to verse 10. In Romans chapter 3, it tells us the condition of the world, the guilt of the world, the condemnation of the world, and the judgment that has already come upon this world. In Romans chapter 3, I'm reading from verse 19. It says, now we know that what things soever the law says, it says to them that are under the law. Then it says that every mouth may be stopped, and
que tout le monde serait connu coupable devant Dieu.
That's why it's an evil world. All the world become guilty before God. There's condemnation hanging on top of the world, the whole world, the whole world, the world of men and women and children, the world of the illiterates and the worlds of the educated, the world of the educated, the world of commerce and the world of politics. The condemnation is hanging on the whole world, and because of that, that's why you don't want to be remain in the world, because of that evil in the world, condemnation of the world, judgment upon the world. What is that condemnation there upon the world? Let's go back to verse 10 now. In verse 10 it says, as it is written, there is none righteous, no, not one. That's the world in which we're living. It says, I think about the world minus the church. When you take the church away from the world, the rest of the world that we call the world, it says, there is none righteous. It's an unrighteous world. It's an impure world. And because it's an unrighteous world, because an impure world, it's a sinful world. It's a transgressing world. It's a world that has gone out of its common sense. A world that does not know the difference between good and bad. And that does not know between the difference between righteousness and unrighteousness. Does not know the difference between what's acceptable and what is not acceptable. Who does shameful things, depraved things, defiled things. That's why it says it is an evil world. Look at verse 11. It says, there is none that understandeth, there is none that seeketh after God. It says, there is none that understandeth, and there is none that seeketh after God. That's why it's a present evil world. You might think that people are seeking after God because they are running here and running there, and they are trying to have this and trying to have that, and they are calling upon the name of God. They are not calling upon the name of God to be saved, to have righteousness, to get to heaven, to have holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord. It's after the riches, the cares of this life. That's what they are running after. Much of the religion of the world is seeking after the things that will crowd out the word of God, the word of conversion, the word of consecration, the word of salvation, the word of sanctification. That's why it says it's a present evil world. Then it says they're all gone out of the way. Verse 12. And they're all together become unprofitable. It says there is none that doeth good, no, not one. That's the world we're talking about. Because they do evil. That's why it's an evil world. Because they do sinful things. That's why they're a sinful world. Because they do demonic things. That's why it's a demonic world, a demonized world. And because they give themselves to Satan. That's why it's a satanic world. And because it is evil, it is sinful, it is demonized, it's satanic. That's why it's an evil world. And the Lord is telling us, if we're going to be part of Him, we come out from among them and we're totally separate. I pray that the grace to come out and be totally separate, the Lord will give unto us in Jesus' name. It says in verse 13, their throat is an open sepulcher. And it says, with their tongues, they have used deceit. And the portion, it says, the poison of herbs is under their lips. Have you met somebody that, you know, never told a lie? The people of the world, they live in lie. I read about two people, A and B. A was talking to B and said, looks like you never tell me the truth, because every time B opens his mouth, a lie is going to come out. Every time he or she opens her mouth, it's a lie, deception, hypocrisy that is going to come out. And then, you know, A told B, can you just once in your life tell me the absolute truth? And B replied, I'm going to tell you the absolute truth right now. And he says, the absolute truth is that I never tell the truth. That's the absolute truth. I never tell the truth. And we can say that about many people in the world. The absolute truth concerning them is that They never tell the truth. They never tell the truth. They know the truth, but they hide that in their heart, and then they deceive, they lie. And that's why the world is evil. To interact with the world, you are interacting with liars. To interact with the world, you are interacting with deceivers. To interact with the world, you are interacting with hypocrisy. To interact with the people of the world, you are interacting with people that their very blood and their very thought and every life is all deception. That's why it's an evil world. I pray will be different in Jesus' name. Because if any man be in Christ, a new creature, and this is how the new creature comes about, he separates us from the world, he saves us from the world, and then you tell the truth in your heart, there's nothing to hide at all. All that characteristic of the world, all that character of the world, everything is taken away from you. And then he says in verse 14, whose mouth is full of cursing and bitterness, and their feet are swift to shed blood. Destruction and misery are in their ways, and the way of peace have they not known. There is no fear of God before their eyes. When you think about that the people of this world, there's no fear of God in their eyes. They act as if they are all atheists. Although they say theoretically they believe in God, it's all in theory. But from their lifestyle, they don't believe in God. They don't believe that God hears every conversation. They don't believe that God sees every thought. They don't believe that God follows them everywhere. They don't believe that God sees every action. They don't believe that God is going to judge all the actions of men. They don't believe, they're unbelievers. They're atheists. Atheists in the sense that they don't really believe in the existence of God. They don't know that God is here with them. They don't know that God is seeing them and he sees through all their hypocrisy. Those are atheists. It says there is no fear of God in their eyes. I pray will be different in Jesus' name. It tells us in James chapter 4, I'm reading from verse 4. James chapter 4, we're looking at verse 4. It tells us in James chapter 4, verse 4, it says, ye adulterers and adulteresses, know ye not that friendship of the world is enmity with God? Stop there for a moment. It says, ye adulterers and adulteresses. Why use such a strong language? Because you see, when you come to the Lord, Jesus Christ is the bridegroom and we are the bride. And you ought to be faithful to God and faithful to Christ as a wife is faithful to the husband. But then when you deviate from that, you give your heart to the world. You give your allegiance to the world. You give your loyalty to the world. Anything you want to do, the first person you think about is that man in the world and that woman in the world. How would they feel? What will they think? You're friend of the world. The ceremonies, you love them. The rituals, you love them. The way they conduct their wedding, you love them. The way they do their burial funeral ceremony, you love them. The way they do their naming ceremony, you love them. The way they dress, you love them. The way they do their functions, you love them. And you love them more than the ways of God. You rather say, what will my neighbors think? Those neighbors, unbelieving neighbors, or neighbors who have been influenced by the world. What will my colleagues say? And those colleagues are people of the world. And you're a friend of the world. It says, ye adulterers and adulteresses. That is, your heart is away from the Lord. Your allegiance, your love, your faithfulness, and your devotion, your dedication is to the world. And it says, you're an adulterer, spiritual adulterer. You're an adulteress, spiritual adulteress. And it says, you're adulterers and you're adulteresses. That's what the Lord calls you. If you die in that condition, you die as spiritual adulterer. If you die in that condition, loving the world, giving your heart to the world, you die as a spiritual adulteress. And where will you spend eternity? Because it says here, adulterers and adulteresses, don't you know that friendship of the world, fellowship of the world, friendship of the world, fellowship of the world, interaction with the world, attachment to the world, commitment to the world is enmity with God. And that shows how evil the world is. Because the world is diametrically opposite to God. And because of that, if you're going to please the Lord, there's one thing, you come out from among them. If you're with the world, you are not with God. If you're with God, you are not with the world. It says here, daughters and daughters, is know ye not that the friendship of the world is enmity with God? Then it says, whosoever therefore will be a friend of the world is an enemy of God. Whosoever therefore, you understand that? Whosoever therefore, the word of God does not know any class distinction. And there are people that will say that the word of God is applied to the poor. It's not applied to the rich. Whosoever therefore. There are people that apply the word of God to the illiterates and to the language people. They don't apply the word of God to those highly educated people. But the word of God says, whosoever therefore. There are some churches where you have a kind of different standard for, you know, those lowly people, those humble people, those, you know, backward people, those village people. And then they say, a low standard that is almost like no standard for the people on top there. Just allow them to come in. We allow them to come in, but if they are not saved, how do they get to heaven? We allow them to come in, but if they are friends of the world, how do they get to heaven? We allow them to come in, but if they do not have this commitment to the Lord and total separation from the world, how do they get to heaven? Because it says, whosoever therefore, a man or a woman, whosoever therefore, a worker or a member of the church, whosoever therefore, a preacher, a pastor, an overseer, or anybody, whosoever therefore shall be a friend of the world will be an enemy of God. I pray you'll not be an enemy of God in Jesus' name. Then it means that you are going to take your stand. You say, this present world is evil, and the Lord is calling me to do just one thing. Come out from among them and be separate, says the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing. I'll be a father unto you, and you shall be my sons, and you shall be my daughters in Jesus' name. We're looking at 2 Peter chapter 2. I'm reading here from verse 20. 2 Peter chapter 2 verse 20, for if after they have escaped the pollutions of the world, after they have escaped the pollutions of the world, would you know that the Bible tells us there are pollutions in the world, there are defilements of the world, that if you are near the world, all their pollutions will splash on you. If you walk with the world, all the pollutions of the world will splash on you. And if you are living in the world, you know, you're their friend, they are your friends, their language will rub on you, their thoughts will rub on you, their plans will rub on you, and all their activities will rub on you. You know, my neighbor is doing that, I want to be there. Those people are doing burial, I want to be there. Those people are doing ministry, I must be there. Those people are doing that ceremony, I ought to be there. Those people are here, that function, I ought to be there. The nearer you are to the world, the more the pollutions of the world will be splashing on you. And it says, if after you have escaped the pollution that's in the world, if you are then through the knowledge of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, if they are again entangled therein, if they are again entangled therein, you escaped when you were born again. You escaped when you repented and you were saved. Many years ago, all those sins were not part of your life. You are separated from them. And they knew, the people of the world, they knew you are not part of them. But now you are going back little by little, one leg inside there, one leg out here. Your mind is there. Your friends are there. And you are more attached to them than the saints of God in the church of the living God. You are again entangled therein. Entanglement means that, you know, it ties you up eventually. That you are not able to wriggle yourself out. You are not able to escape again. Then it says, look at the next verse there. Look at that, the end of that verse. It says, and you are overcome. The latter end is worse with them than the beginning. The latter end is worse with them than the beginning. Those are the people they are cooling off. Those are the people, they say, the convictions we used to have against the world. They've discovered we were too strict. We were too much separated. We were aloof. We were afar from the world. But we need to, you know, learn their language, talk like them, and dress like them, and eat like them, and drink like them. And bring in some kind of behavior like them, so that we can will show them we're not too different. And if we're near, then we can bring them. It says your latter end is worse than the beginning. I'm going to ask you a question. As you are getting older, because you know you are older today than you were yesterday. You are older today than you were last month. You are older today than you were last year. As you are getting older, then your latter years, you are entangled therein. Your latter years, when you are near the coming of the Lord, you are nearer the grave than before. You are nearer the time you are going to leave this world and going to give account to the Lord. You are entangled in the things of the world. What will happen to you? It says your latter end will be worse than your beginning. I pray it will not happen like that. If you do not happen like that, this is the time you are going to take inventory. This time you are going to examine yourself and come out of all those things, and the Lord will cleanse you once again in Jesus' name. In verse 21, it says, for it had been better for them not to have known the way of truth. Then it says, than after they have known it, to turn from the holy commandments delivered unto them. You have known that we shall separate from the world. You have known that we shall be cleansed from all those pollutions of the world. Then you are then entangled therein. It says, your latter end is worse. It would have been better if you didn't know. But now you knew. Then you've gone back into that world again. It says, but it is happened unto them. According to the true proverb, the dog is turned to his wallowing in the mire, and the soul is that was washed to her wallowing in the mire. I pray the Lord will deliver us in Jesus' name. But we thank the Lord because he has power to deliver. He has power to cleanse. He has power to separate us completely from all the sins of the world. And as we come to this workers' retreat, that's what the Lord will do for us. He'll deliver every one of us in Jesus' name. And once again, the courage to be different, and the courage to be clean, and the courage to live a life that is totally committed to the Lord will give unto us in Jesus' name. And the line of demarcation that has been torn down, we're going to erect that wall of demarcation between us and the world again in Jesus' name. That the people of the world will see we are not like them, they are not like us, and we in the church will know we are not like them and they are not like us in Jesus' name. I come to point number two, deliverance and dominion over the polluted evil world. We're coming back to that same Galatians chapter 1. We're looking at it from verse 4. It says, who gave himself for our sins, that he might deliver us from this present evil world. The purpose why Jesus died is so that he will deliver us from this present evil world. And if that does not happen, the purpose of Christ's death on Calvary has not been fulfilled. Once again, I want you to, you know, remember your neighbors who go to church, and remember all this. We go to church too, gospel church. Thank God you go to gospel church. But have you been delivered from this present evil world? Their language, their dressing, their attitude, their lifestyle, their aspirations, their ambitions, their fraud, their iniquity, their peculiarities, the world. Have you been delivered? Other people say, we go to church too. Thank God you go to church too. But as we go to church, how is it with you and the world? The purpose why Jesus Christ died on the cross of Calvary is that he will deliver us from this present evil world. And you find that the love of the world is in your heart. It means something is wrong somewhere. We need to go back to Calvary. You need to go back and be cleansed in the blood of the Lamb. Because when you are cleansed in the blood of the Lamb, there will be a mighty change and a great change. It will happen again in Jesus' name. The world is in enmity against Christ. And if you as a bride of Christ, as wife to the Lord Jesus Christ, if you are so much interested in the world loving you, appreciating you, and you want to do things their way and please the enemy of Christ rather than pleasing Christ, something is wrong with your Christian experience. Look at it. It says, who gave himself one sins that he might deliver us from this present evil world according to the will of God and our Father. That's the will of God. If you are not delivered from the present evil world, you are not in the center of the will of God. You are out of the will of God. I just pray that you will not die in that condition in Jesus' name. We're looking at chapter 6 again, verse 14. Galatians chapter 6, verse 14. It says, but God forbid that I should glory, save in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom the world is crucified unto me. The world is crucified unto me. The world is crucified. That is, I count the world taken away from my presence. And I count that world nailed to the cross. And because the world is nailed to the cross, crucified unto me, it doesn't have any impact on me, any influence on me. The world doesn't have any attraction for me. It's crucified unto me. And I unto the world. It says, I'm a crucified man in the sight of the world, and therefore the world does not love me, does not appreciate me, does not praise me, does not exalt me, does not see any beauty in me, because I as a Christian worker, I as a servant of God, I am crucified unto the world. And look at when Jesus Christ was on the cross, the world has nothing good to say about him. The world, they looked at him and they shook their head and they said, King of the Jews, if he be the King of the Jews, let him come down and then we'll believe him. Didn't he say he was the Son of God? They ridiculed him, they reproached him. And that's the reason why, if you are really crucified to the world will not be appreciating you and loving you and hovering around you and exalting you and giving you all these good names and flattering you, because you are crucified unto the world. That's the distinction, that's the demarcation, that's what the Lord wants to see in his church, that the church is crucified to the world and the world is crucified unto the church as well. Look at John chapter 15. John chapter 15. Here is what Jesus Christ himself said concerning his own disciples. If you are a disciple of Jesus, this will be a reality in your life. This will be the truth about your life. And God is no respecter of persons. You are not looking at what so and so is doing such and such. That's not your business. And so is, you know, near the world and is, you know, one of the preachers. Well, if he's near the world, if he's a friend of the world, he's an enemy of God. He might be a preacher, might be an overseer, might be anybody. But it says that if you are a child of God and you are dedicated to God, you are separated from the world. And you think about yourself, I think about myself, let every other person think about themselves. Look at John chapter 15. I'm reading from verse 18. It says, if the world hates you, you know that it hated me before it hated you. It must be so. There are people that are so eager, they're so hungry for the love of the people of the world. They cannot bear rejection. They cannot bear their names being cast out. They cannot bear being rejected by the people of the world. If you cannot bear being rejected by the people of the world, you love them, you curry their favor, you announce them, you do everything to please them, you'll never please the Lord. You're not on your way to heaven yet. You're not a believer in Christ yet. You're not committed to the Lord Jesus Christ yet. All you want is the applause of the world, the flattery of the world. All you want is the adulation of the world. All you want is, you know, all the cajoling of the world. But it says, if the world hates you, that's a man that you belong to Christ, because the world also hated me. Look at verse 19. If ye were of the world would love his own. If you are of the world would love his own. If they are speaking well of you, they love your kind of Christianity. They love your kind, the way you practice your own Christianity, your own dressing, and what they can get to drink when they come to your house, and then the way you socialize with them, you are very near them, and you show that you are, you know, you are part of them. You are not trying to make yourself holy, 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 high up there. If they say that about you, it means you are not for Christ, because it says, if you were of the world would love his own. The reason they love you, the reason they praise you, the reason they glorify you, the reason they exalt you is because you do not belong to Christ, you belong to the world. I pray things will change. I said things will change. If you are of the world will love you soon. But because you are not of the world. Because you are not of the world. Because you are not of the world. We're pilgrims and strangers here. We're passing through this world. Our real home is on the other side. And because we're strangers here, because we're pilgrims here, that's why it says we've been chosen out of the world. We're not of the world. But I have chosen you out of the world because of that the world hates you. The world hates you. You better bring it back to your life that the world will hate you. Don't expect smiles, love, appreciation. Adjust your mind. Get ready for this. Get ready for this. And some of those people of the world, they live nearby. You see them every day. Get adjusted. Adjust your mind. You'll experience the hatred just for a short time, because we're soon going to get home. I said we're soon getting home. And so for this short time, they'll frown. That's how they demonstrate their hatred. They'll insult you. That's how demonstrate their hatred. They abuse you. That's how they demonstrate their hatred. They'll persecute you. That's how they demonstrate their hatred. Every time you have that insult and that abuse and that insinuation and that kind of negative attitude, you go to the corner of your chamber, your room, say, praise the Lord, I'm not of the world. That's why they hate me. Praise the Lord. They see the difference between me and them. That's why they hate me. Rejoice, because your reward is great in heaven. Look at verse 23. Remember the word that I said unto you, the servant is not greater than his Lord. If they have persecuted me, they will also persecute you. Get ready. If they have kept my saying, they will also keep your, they'll keep yours also. When persecution comes, you'll stand in Jesus' name. Look at John chapter 17. John chapter 17, I'm reading from verse 6. It says in John chapter 17, verse 6, it says, I have manifested thy name unto the men which thou gavest me out of the world. Out of the world. Out of the world. When it saves us out of the world. It doesn't make us to remain in their pollutions, in their defilements, in their lifestyle, in their character, in their evil. It doesn't make us to remain in their fault. It doesn't make us to remain in their drunkenness, in their smoking, in their adultery, in their fornication, in their kind of, you know, lopsided love. It says it saves us out of the world. It says, then in that verse, it says, thine the word, and thou gavest them me, and they have kept thy word. I pray that the testimony of Jesus Christ for his disciples, that testimony will be yours in Jesus' name. Look at verse 14. In verse 14, it says, I have given them thy word, and the world has done what? Tell me out loud. I hated them, and the world hated you yet. In your place of work, have you experienced that hatred yet? In the market where you sell, have you experienced that hatred yet? In your village, have you expressed that hatred yet? You know, there are people that they say, you know, I thank God the way I practice my Christianity. I do my Christianity with wisdom. And with the wisdom I have, you know, the people understand me, they love me, they appreciate me. They said, if everybody practices Christianity like you, that, you know, we're serving idols, you contribute your own quota to serving the idol. And we're doing this in the village, you contribute your part. If everybody did that, then we'll agree with all you Christians. No, you won't agree with us. We are not going to agree with you. We will not worship idols with them in Jesus' name. We will not sacrifice with them in Jesus' name. And sometimes, you know, they even think of you that they want to give you chieftaincy title in the village. It means you are not a Christian. If you were a Christian, you receive the word of God, they will hate you. And they're not going to hate you and then give you chieftaincy title in their village. They say, no, he's not fit. No, he cannot do it. He'll not serve idol. He'll not worship idol. And it says over here, according to the word of God, it says, I've given them thy word, and the world has hated them. Then it says, because they are not of the world, even as I'm not of the world. I pray not that thou shouldest take them out of the world, but that thou shouldest keep them from the evil. They are not of the world, even as I am not of the world. They are not of the world, even as I'm not of the world. You'll not be of the world in Jesus' name. It tells us in Romans chapter 12, reading from verse 1. You're not trying to, you know, cut corners and trying to, you know, manage your Christian stance and, you know, live your Christian life in such a way that you are acceptable to the church and you're acceptable to the world. You're appreciated by the church and then you're appreciated by the world. That you manage your life in such a way that one part of you is, you know, near the church, the other part of you is near the world. There must be a clear-cut distinction between the real child of God and the person of the world. And remember how you used to live when you first came to know the Lord. And if you are now cutting corners and making adjustments and making the world to love you, to appreciate you, something is wrong. You're going to come back fully into the word of God as come back the Lord himself will receive you fully in Jesus' name. It tells us in Romans chapter 12, and I'm reading from verse 1, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that he present your bodies. What are we to present there? Tell me out loud. You know, there are some people that say, well, Christianity does not affect my body. Your body is a temple of God. I can paint it the way I want. No, you cannot. If you are born again, I can put holes in the nose and holes in the ear and holes on the lips and holes on the eyelids. I can put holes everywhere and put all the jewelry there. No, you cannot. If you're a real Christian, the word of God does not leave us to decide, this is what I'll do, this is what I will not do. It gives us the word of God very clearly, and it tells us that if you're a real child of God, I beseech you therefore by the mercies of God that you present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. If you get painted up like the people of the world, that does not, it's not acceptable to God. If you put holes everywhere and put jewelry everywhere, that's not acceptable to God. If you kind of burn up yourself because you're trying to look like the world, you are dark and you want to become so light like the people of the world, that's not of God, and that is not acceptable to God. You don't want to be acceptable to the world. You want to be acceptable unto the Lord. And it says in verse 2, and be not conformed to this world. Give me a good amen there. Be not conformed. Be not conformed. What's conformity? When you change things, you know, you adjust your dress and adjust your style and adjust, you know, your family, adjust everything to just look like the world more and more, talk like the world more and more, eat like the world more and more, celebrate like the world more and more, and bring in their language, their concept more and more. Be different. That's what it says. And be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. that she may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. I pray that every one of us will come into that perfect will of God in Jesus' name. In James chapter 1, we're reading from verse 26. It says, if any man, notice that any man, notice that any man, that includes the women, to any man, any woman, that actually means anyone. If anyone among you, among us here, among us workers, among us leaders, among us preachers and pastors, among us overseers, there are many people that forget that, you know. They think that, you know, the overseers are excused for obedience to the word. Some people excuse the wives of the overseers and the pastors. They excuse them from the word. It's like, you know, oh, she's wife of the pastor. She can, you know, she's an island by herself. The word of God does not affect her. The commandments of God do not affect her. The conditions of getting to heaven does not affect her because she is pastor's wife. Other people excuse the children of her pastor. He is a child of the pastor. And so all the doctrines and all the things we're teaching, that doesn't affect them. But it says, if any man, anyone among us, from the pastor, from the highest to the lowest, it says, if any man among you seem to be religious and brightness not his tongue, but deceiveth his own heart. Deceiveth. Who is he deceiving? Tell me out loud. You know, there are people that when they are coming to the church, they remove all those things they have, they put in the bag. And then they come to the church, it's like, I'm one of you. We dress the same way. We act the same way. And then when they go out, they remove all those things because now I'm away from the precincts, I'm away from the premises, I'm away from the environs of the church. And now they can do whatever, say whatever. Those are not Christians. Those are just chameleons. When they are near the church, they look like the church people. And when they are outside in the world, they look like ordinary people. You meet them outside, you are shocked. You see their behavior outside, you are shocked. Those are not Christians. Those are just people trying to live in two worlds at the same time. It says over here, he deceiveth his own heart. That man's religion is vain. That man's worship is vain. That man's, you know, commitment is vain. And it says, pure religion and undefiled before God and the Father is this: to visit the fatherless and the widows in their affliction, and to keep himself unspotted from the world. To keep himself unspotted from the world. 1 John chapter 2. I read from verse 15. Love not the world. Love not the world. See, the word of God is very clear. And if we're children of God, we walk by the precepts of the children of God. We don't walk by the examples of other people. You know, there was a Judas among the disciples of the Lord, and there was a John among the disciples of the Lord. But whether it's John or Judas, that doesn't even matter. It's the words of Jesus Christ. This is what he said. This is what he commanded. Judas may do whatever he wants to. That's between him and the Lord. And John may live the way he wants. That's between him and the Lord. This is what the Lord has said. And so you want to bring your conviction. You want to bring your understanding. You want to bring your commitment. You want to bring your consecration into the obedience of the word of God. That this is what the Lord had said, love not the world, and the things that are in the world. Then he says, if any man love the world, if any man love the world, if any woman love the world, I hope that you are not getting to the position where you exalt a man or a woman in the church, in this church, above the word of God. that you see he is a respected member of the church, he is a highly honored member of the church of God, of the church over here, because of his position. Rather lean towards him than the word of God. No, it should not be like that. There should not be a pope in the church. That whatever he says, even contrary to the word of God, however he lives, contrary to the word of God, will say the pope, that's the pope, and that's what he has said. And although the word of God says this is the way we're going to live, therefore you are not patterning your life after any man, after any woman in this church. Everyone is free to express his own Christianity, our own Christianity, the way they understand. But you understand the word of God. It says, love not the world. And since the commandment has come to us, we're not looking at what this one has done, what this one is not doing. Love not the world. Neither the things that are in the world. If any man, if any woman, if any boy, if any girl, any child, if he loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the heart, the lust of the flesh, and the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, is not of the Father, but is of the world. And the world passeth away, and the lust thereof. But he that doeth the will of God, tell me, abideth forever. I pray we'll abide forever in Jesus' name. 1 John chapter 4 verse 4. Ye of God, little children, and overcome them, because greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. The one in the world would like to pollute the gospel, would like to defile the gospel, would like to turn things around, would like to make you cringe and crawl and be conquered by the world because of, you know, he wants everybody to come into the mold of the world. But because we have God and greater is he that is in us than he that is in the world, will stand in this gospel in Jesus' name. We've looked at number one, the description, the danger of the present evil world. Number two is the deliverance and the dominion over the polluted evil world. Number three, the duty of disciples in the perverted evil world. Why are we here? Why has the Lord left us in the world? At our sake, we're not to be like the world. We're not to dress like the world, or drink like the world, or live like the world, or walk like the world, or follow after the world. Why are we here then? We're looking at Matthew chapter 5. Matthew chapter 5. I'm reading here from verse 14. Matthew chapter 5. Reading from verse 14. It shows us very clearly why we are here, why the Lord has left us here, why he has not taken us home. And every day we spend here, we must be conscious of this. There is a division between us and the world, a demarcation between us and the world, a difference between us and the world. There is a separation between us and the world. And yet we have a responsibility, the duty of disciples in the perverted evil world. In Matthew chapter 5 verse 14, it says, ye are the light of the world. I pray you'll be a light in this world. Then it says, a city that is set on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do men light a candle and put it under a bushel, but on a candlestick, and it giveth light to all that are in the house. Let your light so shine before men. Let your light so shine before men. Let your light, the light of the gospel, the light of the doctrine, the light of the teaching, the light that you have received, that you are born again, that you are converted, that you are consecrated to, that you are sanctified, that you are holy, let that light of holiness so shine, let that light of sanctification so shine, let that light of consecration so shine, let that light of the teaching, of the doctrine, of the word of God so shine before men, that they may see your good works, and then they'll glorify your Father which is in heaven. It will happen like that in Jesus' name. It tells us in John chapter 17. John chapter 17. I'm reading again from verse 15. John chapter 17. Why don't you back up to verse 14? It says, I've given them thy word, and the world has hated them, I pray that you'll be able to bear the hatred of the world. I said you'll be able to bear the hatred of the world. Because if you are so weak-minded and so anemic and you have straw for backbone, that you cannot bear the hatred of the world, then you'll not be able to stand. But says, I've given them your word, and the world has hated them. Because they are not of the world, even as I'm not of the world. It says, I pray not that thou shouldest take them out of the world, but that thou shouldest keep them from the evil. They are not of the world, even as I'm not of the world. Sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth. And look at verse 18. As thou hast sent me into the world, even so have I also sent them into the world. It says, they are not of the world. Keep them from the evil in the world. Keep them from the pollutions of the world. Keep them from the sinfulness in the world. And yet I'm sending them to the world as thou hast sent me into the world. Mark chapter 16. The reason why we're here, the reason why you are here, the duty of disciples in this perverted world. In Mark chapter 16, I'm reading from verse 15. It says in verse 15, and he said unto them, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. That's why we're here. We're not here to compete with them in their fashion. We're not here to compete with them in the Olympic Games. We're not here to compete with them in their drinking. We're not here to compete with them in their fraud. We're not here to compete with them in the riches and inheritance of the world. We're here for one reason. We're here to obey the word of our Lord. And it says that we preach the gospel to every creature in the world. We're going to do it in Jesus' name. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5, I'm reading from verse 17. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, reading from verse 17. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, it's a new creature. Old things are passed away and all things have become new. I pray that will be real in your life in Jesus' name. And then it says, and all things of God, all things of God, and he has reconciled to himself by who reconciled, who has reconciled to himself, us to himself, by the Lord Jesus Christ, and he has given us the ministry of reconciliation, to which that is to say that God was in Christ reconciling the world unto himself. God reconciling the world unto himself. They are enmity against God, and he has sent us to go to them and preach to them and bring them unto himself. Then it says in that verse 19, and he has committed unto us the ministry of the word of reconciliation. Now then, we are ambassadors for Christ. As though God did beseech you by us, we pray you in Christ's stead, on behalf of Christ, be you reconciled to God. I pray that our duty will fulfill in Jesus' name. In Titus chapter 2, I'm reading from verse 11 and verse 12. Titus chapter 2, verses 11 and 12. For the grace of God that bringeth salvation has appeared unto all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lust, we should live how? Tell me out loud. Soberly. Frivolity should not be in the life of any child of God. And then a worker, and then a minister, then a preacher, then a pastor, then an overseer. Superficiality and carnality and frivolity and, you know, just being light, light-heartedness should not be in the life of any child of God, not to talk of a minister, a worker, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lust, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly where? In this present world. That's why we're here. We're here to show what the holiness of God actually means. We're here to show what the holiness of the Lord actually implies. Romans chapter 10. In Romans chapter 10, we'll see our duty and responsibility. Romans chapter 10, I'm reading from verse 17. So then, faith cometh by hearing. when you declare the word of God to those neighbors, to those worldly people, fail to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ comes by hearing. When you tell them about repentance and about faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, faith coming by hearing, they must hear from you. They must see it in your life, how they can come to Christ, how they can come to the Lord, how they can be saved. And then it says in verse 18, after saying that faith coming by hearing and hearing by the word of God, but I say, have they not heard? Yes, verily, truly, certainly, their sound went into all the earth, and their words unto the ends of the world. That's why the Lord has left us here, that we're to preach the word of God unto the people of the world. And I pray that every one of us will be faithful in Jesus' name. Number one, the description and the danger of this present evil world. Number two, the deliverance and dominion over the polluted evil world. And number three, the duty of disciples in the perverted evil world. The Lord has shown us our responsibility, our duty, and the things we ought to do. And I pray that we are going to be obedient. I pray that we will be obedient and we will be faithful and loyal to the Lord in Jesus' name. I'm now concluding with John chapter 8, and I'm reading from verse 31. John chapter 8, verse 31. It says, then said Jesus to those Jews which believed on him, if he continue in my word, if he continue in my word, what's his word? Separation from the world. What's his word? Living different from the world. What's his word? That if the world hates us, we should not mind that. That's the lot of a real child of God. What's his word? That we're going to all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. We have a duty, we have a responsibility. If he continue in my word, then are ye my disciples indeed. The Lord has called us together. Gather my saints together unto me. Gather my servants together unto me. Gather my stewards together unto me. Gather my sons and daughters together unto me. Those that have made a covenant with me by sacrifice. You want to renew your covenant with the Lord. You want to lay everything upon the altar. You want to say, Lord, now I know that those who love the world and those who can live like the world, they are adulterers and adulteresses. And I want to now recommit myself to the Lord that they, during this, work as all the kind of cares of the world, all the pollution, so all the riches of the world, all the ambition of all the aspiration of the world, trying to get into my heart, into my life. I'm going to drop everything and I'm going to lay everything upon the altar once again, and I'm going to serve the Lord like I really need to serve the Lord. And then the gospel has given me to go and give to the world. I'm going to do everything the Lord expects of me. The Lord now wants us to come before him and to pray, to lay everything upon the altar. And I pray that this will be the beginning of a great revival in your soul, in your spirit, in your heart, in your life, and in the church of the living God in Jesus' name. Let's rise up and talk to the Lord in prayer and say, Lord, here we are. Lord, here we are. Lord, here we are. We're going to really lay everything upon the altar this time now. During this workers' retreat, the world that is trying to encroach on our lives, on our conviction, we're going to kick out that world, and we're going to not live a separated life, a sanctified life, a purified life, a purged life, a committed life unto the Lord. Open your mouth and talk to the Lord in prayer and say, Lord, here am I. Lord, here am I. I want to serve you. Lord, here am I. I want to serve you. Lord, here am I. I want to serve you. I want to live like you want me to live. I want to behave like you want me to behave. The Lord is calling upon you that you will do what he wants you to do. You will live the way he wants you to live. If the world has come back, if the world has come back, if the world has come back, come into your life again. It says your latter end is worse than the beginning. But you say, oh Lord, I lay to the altar all the attitude of the world, all the pollutions of the world, all the pornography of the world, all the language of the world, all the behavior of the world, all the compromise of the world, all the adultery and the fornication of the world, all the hypocrisy of the world, all the drunkenness of the world, all the smoking of the world, all the fraud, all the stealing of the world that has come back into your life. You want to lay your life on the altar to this saying, Lord, I must be different. I must be different. afraid. Remember who you were when you first came to the Lord. You were a new creature in Christ, and all those things of darkness, everything went away from your life. But now carelessness, and now there's frivolity, and now there's superficiality, now there's carnality, now there's worldliness that has come back. You're telling the Lord, oh Lord, things must change. Things must change. It must not continue like this. It will not continue like this. I lay my everything on the altar once again. I lay everything on the altar once again. Following the examples of people, Pastor so and so, this is the way he talks and this is the way he jests. You're not following Pastor so and so, you are following the Bible. The wife of Pastor so and so, this is the way she behaves, this is the way she dresses, this is the way she does. You're not following the wife of Pastor so and so, and the son or the daughter of Pastor so and so, that's how they behave, that's how they talk. You're not following his son, you're not following his daughter, you are following the word of God. And whoever it is, if any man loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. A man is not your example. Anybody can be like a Judas, anybody can be Ananias and Sapphira, anybody can be an Achan. That's not your example. You are following the example of the Lord Jesus Christ. You are saying, Lord, I want to serve you. I didn't know brother so and so when I became born again. I didn't know sister so and so when I became born again. Or this people they call daddy and mommy. I didn't know any daddy or any mommy when I became born again. I knew Jesus Christ. I knew the word of God. I knew the doctrine of the Bible. And I want to stand on the word of God. Bring back the standard of the word of God into your heart, into your life. In your heart, in your life, and say, Lord, here is where I stand. Here is where I stand. Here is where I stand. God, help me. Lay it on the altar once again. Lay it on the altar once again. So and so is cold, therefore I'll be cold. No, sir. So and so is unfaithful, therefore I'm going to be unfaithful. No, sir. So and so is worldly, so I'm going to be worldly. No, sir. So and so is frivolous, I'm going to be frivolous. No, sir. So and so is, a friend of the world, therefore I'm going to be a friend of the world. No, sir. I want, if I'm the only Christian that will fulfill the Bible, if I'm the only Christian that will live according to the word of God, I want to live by the standard of the word of God. The world will hit you. The world will hit you. The world will hit you. If anybody hates you, they are just part of the world. Just live by the standard. Go your way. Live by the standard of the word of God. And say, Lord, I lay everything on the altar once again. I don't want to be an adulterer. I don't want to be an adulteress. That will be an enemy of God. Friendship of the world. Friendship of the world. Friendship of the world. If you're a friend, if you're a friend of the world, you're an enemy of God. Why don't you come to the Lord today and say, oh Lord, now I understand. Now I understand. I know what has happened in the past, but now I want to live for you. I want to live for you. I want to live for you. Persecution may come. Hatred may come. Opposition may come. Make up your mind. If you are rejected by men, the Lord will receive you. Live for the Lord. Live for the Lord. Live for the Lord. Be not unequal yoke together with unbelievers. Touch not the unclean thing. Be ye separate, says the Lord. And I will receive you. And ye shall be my sons and my daughters, says the Lord Almighty. Commit yourself afresh to the Lord. Afresh to the Lord. And look away from the example of anybody and everybody. Even of the good people. Of the good people. You can better than them. But so and so is prayerful. I want to follow him. No, you can better than that. Sister so and so is a fervent and devoted to. I want to follow her. No, don't follow her. Don't follow her. Follow the word of God. Follow the word of God. Instead of looking at other people, I'll be like him. I'll be like her. Just be like the word of God wants you to be. You can be better than them, higher than them, greater than them, holier than them, more spiritual than them. Don't follow the example of anybody, even the good people, even the good people. Follow the examples of the Lord. I know this is the way, and this is the word of God. Walk ye therein. Earnestly contending for the faith once delivered unto the saints. looking unto Jesus, looking unto Jesus, looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. The word of God does not tell us looking unto Peter, that's an apostle, looking unto John, that's an apostle, looking unto Mary, that's the mother of Jesus, looking unto Martha, looking unto Lazarus, looking unto Zacchaeus, looking unto Jesus. The example of Jesus, the pattern of Jesus, the life of Jesus, walking in the footsteps of the Lord Jesus Christ. Come back to the word of God. Come back to the word of God. Anybody can go astray. Anybody can backslide. Stand on the word. Live by the word. Bring back everything you've got. Once again, your commitment to the word. Your commitment to the word. Your commitment to the word. Be ye separate, says the Lord. Be ye separate, says the Lord. Be ye separate, says the Lord. Then I will receive you. Be a father unto you, and you shall be my sons and my daughters, says the Lord.
In Jesus' name we pray.